face and just put it on his fingers as he's playing. See how fast he's going. Let's all stand and join together in singing, "These Are the Days of Elijah."
Thank you. Amen. Thank you. And we are glad to see you in worship this morning. We are glad that you've chosen to worship with us today at Grace Methodist Church. If you are worshiping with us in person, we'd like to invite you to complete the tear-off section of your bulletin so we can have a record of your attendance today. There's also a place where you can leave us prayer requests or let us know that someone's better and we can take that person off of our prayer list. So we do read those, and it's a great way for us to keep in touch with what's going on with you. Meanwhile, if you're watching us online via Facebook, we also say welcome to you. We'd love for you to leave us a comment on our page or maybe even share our worship service so that others may worship with you today. While you are doing those things, there are several announcements that I would like to draw to your attention, and you'll find all of our announcements on the back of your bulletin. We are pleased to have Tim Datwyler as our guest speaker today, and you'll be hearing more from him a little bit later. Also note that the church office will be closed tomorrow for Labor Day, so we will be back in the office on Tuesday. We do want to ask you to continue to pray for the convening conference of the Global Methodist Church, which will be in San Jose, Costa Rica, in September, beginning about, I believe, September 20th. So there is a prayer guide available if you'd like to pray each and every day for that important work in the GMC. And I'll be talking more over the next coming weeks. I'm going to begin a series next week about what it means to be a Global Methodist and talk about our mission statement in the Global Methodist Church and what it means to us. Also note that a new women's Bible study will begin a week from tomorrow in room 105 and over the book of Ruth. Deborah Lynch will be leading that. You can sign up by completing the sign-ups by letting us know on your tear-off section of your bulletin, or see Deborah Lynch or call us at the office for more information. Also, several representatives from the leadership board will be in the fellowship hall after worship to answer your questions about the report that was presented last week. So if you have questions or conversation with them, they want to make themselves available to you. We will be receiving Holy Communion today as the service closes. If you're our guest, you're welcome to receive. If you would like to receive in a different way, there are the prepackaged sets back near the sound booth if you don't want to come forward. And if you aren't able to come forward, just wave at us and we'll be glad to bring the sacrament to you. So we will be receiving Holy Communion to close our worship. One last note, and Jean Lay's birthday is today. I know that she's not here today, but when you see her, be sure to wish her a happy birthday from us. Jean is the only remaining charter member of Grace's beginning way back in 1950. So we want to say a special happy birthday to her. All right, anything else this morning? Okay, then let us pray together. Oh Lord, we are so grateful to be in your house today. Lord, we are so grateful that you have brought us through the week that we have completed. And Lord, as we look forward to yet another week, Lord, we know that it's going to be full of challenges and difficulties as well. But Lord, what we know is that you are always with us, that you have promised to never leave us or forsake us. And so, Lord, we invite your Holy Spirit into our worship service this morning. We pray that you would lead us and guide us. Lord, we pray that the things that we say and the things that we do, the songs we sing, Lord, that they would not be ours, but they would be yours. Lord, we give them to you as an act of worship and praise, for you are worthy of all that we can do and all that we can bring to you. So, Lord, as Tim comes to deliver your message, we pray your Holy Spirit would be in him. Lord, that you would give us the ears to hear and, Lord, the hearts to respond to what you're doing in us and in his work as well. Lord, we know that you have promised to never leave us or forsake us, and so we invite your Holy Spirit to lead us and guide us today, to draw us closer to you and to one another. And it's all these things we pray in the name of Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. And I'd like to invite you now to stand as we recite together that ancient creed, the Apostles' Creed, that Christians has been forming our faith for centuries. And so I invite you to join with me as we affirm our faith together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Be seated as our ushers come to receive our offering this morning, and as they come, let us pray together. Oh Lord, we are so grateful for your many blessings, the blessing of friends and family, the blessing of a holiday weekend, the blessing of gathering together to worship you, to give you our worries and troubles, to lay them at your feet, Lord, to hear your word of love and grace and care for us. And so, Lord, as we think about all of your many blessings, Lord, we are overwhelmed at how good you have been to us. And so now, Lord, as we give you back a portion of what you've given us, we ask your blessing on these gifts that we give, and we pray that they would be used so that others might know the good news of Jesus Christ. And it's all these things we ask in the name of Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Thank you.
Amen. Please be seated. As we come to a time of prayer in our service, I do want to remind you of the prayer list that is on the back of your bulletin. I'd like to encourage you to take that home with you this week and continue to pray for each of those needs throughout the week. And I hope that will be a starting point for you as we pray each and every day for our own needs and the needs of the world around us. Of course, you will see on our prayer list the praying for our world and for our nation, for our country. We also pray for our students and teachers as they begin a new school year. You see our local ministry partners listed there, as well as our missionaries. And I know that Tim would probably tell you, as Joey and others have, that our prayers are as important as our support for them. And so we want them to know that we're praying for them, for God to work in and through their work wherever they are across the world. So we continue to pray for those missionary friends that are working to spread the good news of Jesus wherever they are. I did want to update you on a couple of folks. Bob and Wanda Bryant are slowly improving, so we are grateful for that. We continue to pray for them. Amy Colvin is improving. We're grateful for that. We've already mentioned the convening conference and the things that are going on at our church, so we want to lift those up and ask for God to work in those circumstances. Also, we want to continue to pray for Janelle Willis, as she has some important things coming up this week, so we want to continue to pray for her. So last I heard, Sammy Maremi is doing better, so we're grateful for that, and we want to ask for continued healing for him. So those are some of the ones that I know of that are in need. Do you know of others that you'd like to mention today, this morning, who are in need of our thoughts and prayers? I know we have several unspoken requests that we're praying for as well, so we want to remember those. Any others this morning? All right, then let us pray together. Oh Lord, we are so grateful that you are not just the God of the United States, not just the God of Ruston or Louisiana, but that, God, you are big enough to be the God of the entire world. That as we gather to worship this morning, that many people, millions of people all over the world are gathering and singing some of the same songs and reading some of the same scriptures and praying to you because you are worthy of all of our praise and honor. And so, Lord, we are so grateful that you are a global God who is much bigger than just our local work, that has a heart for reaching people all over the world with the good news of Jesus Christ. And so, Lord, as Tim comes to share with us in a few moments about his work, Lord, we ask your blessing on his work in Ecuador. We ask your blessing on that country, just as we pray for our own. And so, Lord, we ask that you would work and move in those places, as well as in our own lives, in our own church, in our own city, our own country. Lord, we ask that you would do great and mighty things in us and through us. Lord, even as we gather in your house this morning, we are mindful of the needs that are all around us. We do continue to pray for our world, for our country, and Lord, even our local area, that you would continue to work in and through the things that happen. Lord, we also pray for our ministry and mission partners, both here and in other places of the world. We pray that you would work in and through their work, and Lord, that you would bless it. Lord, we also know we have needs in our own congregation for our church and for our people. Lord, we continue to lift up so many that are sick, and we're grateful to hear that some of them are recovering and getting better, and we ask your continued healing touch to be upon them. For others who are facing procedures, recovering from procedures, or maybe just under the weather, we ask that you would be with them as well. Lord, we also remember so many who have lost a loved one to death and ask that you surround them with your comfort and peace. And now, Lord, as we gather in your house this morning, we may have other worries and concerns on our hearts and minds. Maybe it is about our world. Maybe it is about something going on with friends and family. Maybe it's something going on at work or at school. But Lord, whatever it is, what we know is that you are still on the throne, that you are still God over all, and that most of all, you love us, you care for us, and you hear us when we pray. And it's all these things we ask in the name of Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Amen. Thank you, choir. Now it is our turn to lift our praises to God. Would you stand as we sing together, "To God Be the Glory," number 531.
Thank you.
Amen. Please be seated. I am pleased to introduce Tim Datwyler, and I know it's not an introduction for many of us that Tim has been at Grace on a number of occasions, has filled this pulpit while I've been away, and Tim has had a relationship with Grace for many years, and we're grateful to be a small part of his work in Ecuador. I asked Tim, when I was visiting with him, how long he has been in Ecuador, and he said he's been over there for 20 years, and he told me the name of the town where he's, the city where he's working, but I'm afraid I would butcher it, so I'm not going to try to pronounce it. But Tim has been stateside for just a couple of days, and he'll be going back to Ecuador in a few weeks, so we are grateful to have him spend some time with us while he is here in America. So Tim, would you come and read your scripture? Would you come and bring us God's message? We're grateful for you and for all your work.
Thank you, Pastor. It's good to be here with you all this morning. It's a pleasure always to come to Grace and see familiar faces and be able to put my eyes on your faces and know that the prayers that we've received are from you and from many others, and we thank you for that. Dana's not with me. She's back home. She's actually filling the pulpit today as well, so she sends her greetings and her love to you as well. Today, we're going to take a look at a familiar scripture in John chapter 3, starting in verse 1. And the Word of God says, "Now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, 'Rabbi, we know that you're a teacher that's come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him.' Jesus answered him, 'Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot enter the kingdom of God.' Nicodemus said to him, 'How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born?' Jesus answered, 'Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes and hears its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the spirit.' Nicodemus said to him, 'How can these things be?' Jesus answered him, 'Are you the teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Truly, truly, I say to you, we speak of what we know and bear witness to what we have seen, but you do not receive your testimony. If I have told you earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe when I tell you heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except he who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And Moses lifted up the serpent in the desert, or in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him will have eternal life." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
I shared this scripture with our congregation in Chaquibamba. That's the name of our town. So I wanted to share it with you. And we've been studying the book of John, and I've looked at John through in my preparations for messages that we've shared over the last couple months. And I came to the realization that these miracles and these stories about Jesus always starts out with these meetings with these not very strange people, but people that you wouldn't think that he'd be meeting with. And he starts talking about the things, the material or the physical things, and moves to spiritual things. And just like Nicodemus here, he says you need to be born again. And the first thing Nicodemus thinks is, well, I've got to get back in my mother's womb and be born again, and that's not possible. And I've come to realize that Jesus isn't focusing on these physical needs. He's focusing on the spiritual things. And so many times when we look at the scripture, or we come to Jesus for help or whatever, we're really looking at what he can give us physically. And we're not really looking beyond that at the spiritual things that God really wants to share with us and be intimate with us about. You know, when God created the world, He created the plants and everything, and those are on a single dimension. And then he created the animals. And the animals are on a two-dimensional plane. They exist, but they have this conscious or instinct that they crave things and they feel those desires. But when he created man, he created us different than all the rest of the creation, because he breathed his spirit into us, and we're mind, body, and spirit. We're three-dimensional. And so God created the world, but he set that tree in the middle of it, right? And he said, you can eat of anything you want in this garden, but you can't eat of that. And what's the first thing we did? We went for that what we couldn't have. And we got what we didn't want. At that moment in time, but prior to that, man communed with God in an intimate level. They were one and one, and it even says that God walked with them in the cool of the evening in the garden. Can you imagine that, God walking side by side with you right there in the garden, just talking about things, about this plant or that animal or whatever, and just being on that level. But at the moment man ate that fruit and said, I want this because I like it, I see it with my eyes, and I want it, I desire it. There was a separation between us and God. And at that point, the spirit in us just was kind of squashed or put out or died, essentially. And up until the time Jesus died on that cross, that relationship wasn't restored. And when Jesus is saying here with Nicodemus, he says, you know, you need to be born again because your spirit is dead. You can't see the things of God. You can't understand why I'm here. Sure, Nicodemus recognized that he was a man of God. God sent him because he was doing these miracles, and that's the only way he could be doing these miracles is because God's hand, it's God's spirit was over him. But he couldn't figure out what it meant when Jesus said, you need to be born again. You know, when I was a young man, I had a lot longer hair. You probably don't believe me, but my hair was down to my shoulders at that time. And Dana, my wife, she wasn't my wife then, but I really liked her. And she would always invite me to these Christian concerts in California. In California, we were experiencing at that time what they call the Jesus movement. And all these tilt-up warehouses that were there, they became pop-up churches and concert venues. And she would invite me quite frequently to those, and I would go to those because I could go with her. I really wasn't going to hear the message or the music or anything, but I was going because she invited me and I could go. And I can remember distinctly that several people would walk up to me afterwards and say, have you been born again? And I really didn't, I was like Nicodemus, I didn't understand what that meant. It always bothered me. And then when I came into a relationship with Jesus Christ, when I finally gave my life to Jesus Christ and someone came up to me and said, have you been born again? And I said, well, yes, I've been born again. I understood that. That used to be a common phrase for us at that time Have you been born again? And I think we've lost that. And when's the last time have you heard that? We just quit saying that in church anymore. Nicodemus goes on and on in this with this discourse with Jesus. And you know, I find it interesting that this is a man that has studied the Word of God, the Word of God that existed at that time. He knew it inside and out. He was basically a lawyer for the Word of God. But yet he couldn't figure out what Jesus was trying to say right here. I knew a man in a church in California. He had been in the church for 25 years. He'd served on committees and boards and was a long-standing member of the church. 25 years, he sat in the pews, listened to messages. But he'd never heard that he needed to be born again. Never heard that he needed to receive Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. Never heard that he needed to repent of his sins and receive the forgiveness that God had to offer him. Until one day he heard a message. Pastor had preached there, and Bill came up to the altar and gave his life to Jesus Christ. Can you imagine 25 years? And then finally realizing that this is what it's all about? Bill gave his life to Jesus Christ that day. 6 months later, he went for an annual checkup to the doctor and was diagnosed with terminal cancer. Bill spent the next 3 years of his life that God gave him knocking on doors, sharing with people how important it was to give their life to Jesus Christ. I remember one morning we had a men's breakfast and Bill was there to share with us, and he gave each of us men a little piece of a pack of papers that were seven papers that were stapled together. He'd torn them out. He hadn't cut them with scissors or anything. He just tore the pages and gave us these booklets, and he says, "This is a booklet of gratefulness. Each day of this week, I want you to write down something you're grateful for." And he says, "You see my booklet here? Each one of these pages say, I'm grateful because I'm still alive." Bill was thankful just because God gave him one more day of life. Jesus was offering Nicodemus this gift of life. Not just a life to exist, but new life in Jesus Christ. New birth. I know you guys are all in a transitional stage here at the church. From what you were to what you are now, or what you're becoming. And it's almost as if, I want you to think about this, it's a new birth for you all. It's a new place for you all. It doesn't have to be what it was before, because it's what God wants it to be right now. Where you are. Where you are right here at Grace, right here at Ruston. What opportunities that he wants to give to you, and you can experience that in new birth, in how he wants to move in each and every one of your lives. You know, what our ministry was when we were before COVID is not what it is today. And I was sharing with Sunday school class this morning that, you know, a lot of things that we were doing then, we're not doing now. And people ask, well, how is your children's program, or how is this program? And I said, well, the numbers are down in each one of those. But we're doing things like teaching sewing, teaching how to screen print t-shirts. I'm teaching electronics. Our children's program isn't led by necessarily Dana and myself now. It's led by a previous generation of our students that have stepped up in leadership. And we're kind of supervise counseling roles in that, and that's new for us. And when you add all these things up, we're actually in total, our ministry is ministering to more people than it was before. It's just not in the same way. It's not just on Sunday morning. It's throughout the week in different times and different slots and where things happen in those time periods. I guess what I'm trying to say is that, you know, we've all, if we believe in Jesus Christ and accepted him as our Lord and Savior, we've had this new birth. What Jesus was talking about, we've experienced that and we know what that is. But I don't think that's the end of it per se, because God gives us new opportunities and new births a lot of times in our lives, in our walk with him. And I think that's where you all are right now. I think it's a great opportunity for you. You guys have a mission field that's just wide open. And I was talking with Kevin the other day and talking about missions, and you know, we both agree. Your mission field's here, mine's in Ecuador. It's just where we've been called and where we've been led. The question is, are we going to step through and step up when God calls us? And does it always have to look the way we think it should look? I hope not, because what God sees is so much different than what we see. You know, God can see behind us, at us, and before us. And if I could just get a glimpse of what he's looking at before us, I think I'd be able to walk with him a whole lot better or a whole lot easier. But that's not always the case. And so we have to walk by faith. And walking by faith means that we just let him lead us wherever that is, wherever that takes us. It's not always going to be a smooth road. It's not always going to be like we imagine it, but it is the way in his will for our lives and for his ministry that he wants to work and do through us, each and every one of us. Thank you for your support, your prayers, because what we're doing where we are, we couldn't do it without you, without Grace. This relationship we've had with Grace, I think we've been in partnership with you all for over 25 years. Long time, long enough for my hair to fall out. And that's a testimony in itself. But we've had a long partnership, and we've walked together through a lot of things, and we thank you for that, for your faithfulness. And God calling you and us into this relationship. So I hope that you feel and you understand that even though we're thousands of miles apart, that we're still in ministry together. And we do lift you all up here at Grace and at Ruston quite often in prayer. And there are several of our folks in Chalcobamba that do ask about you all, and we share with them what we do know, and they pray for you all. I thank you for this opportunity to share with you, and I'd like to close in prayer. Father God, we thank you for this day. Thank you for the time that we could study your word, and look at your word and see how we can apply it to our lives, Lord. We thank you for the opportunity that you extend to us to birth us anew with your Spirit and restore our relationship with you and commune with you as you did in the beginning in the creation. Use your word to transform us, to purify us, and to sanctify us, that we might be your people and you might be our God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Tim.
One of the things that we have in common with Christians all over the world is that we gather at this table to remember what Jesus did for us through his life, death, and resurrection. And so I'd like to invite you to take your hymnal and turn with me to page number 730 as we prepare to celebrate a sacrament of Holy Communion and remember all that Jesus has done for us through his life, death, and resurrection. Hear now this invitation. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who truly love him, who earnestly repent of their sin, who dwell in charity with their neighbors and intend to live a holy life. Draw near with faith and take this holy sacrament to your comfort, making your humble confession to Almighty God. Let us pray. Almighty and most merciful God, we confess and lament that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. Because the remembrance of our sin is more than we can bear, have mercy on us and forgive us. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, pardon us of all that is past, and grant that we may ever serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. In his great mercy, our Almighty God and Heavenly Father has promised forgiveness of sins to all who repent and with true faith turn to him. May he have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear these comforting words that Jesus Christ our Savior says to all who truly turn to him. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Amen. Would you join with me in the great thanksgiving? The Lord be with you and with your spirit. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give our thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and good to give him thanks and praise. It is right and our joy to give thanks to you in all places and at all times, Almighty Father. You are the source of all truth, life, and love. You made us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When in our sinfulness we turned away from you and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore, we praise you with the angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, forever singing this hymn to the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. All praise and glory is yours, O God our Father, for in your tender mercy you gave your only Son, Jesus Christ, to the world. Your Spirit anointed him to bring good news to the poor, to bind up the brokenhearted, to comfort those who mourn, to proclaim freedom for captives, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce the year of the Lord's favor. In obedience to your will, he stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself once for all, that by his suffering and death we might be saved. By his resurrection, he broke the bonds of death, trampling hell and Satan under his feet. As our great high priest, he ascended to your right hand in glory, that we might come with confidence before the throne of grace. On the night that he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, Jesus took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate this memorial of our redemption, O Father, receiving these gifts of bread and wine with thanksgiving for the death and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ. Sanctify them by your word and Holy Spirit to be for us the body and blood of Christ. Sanctify us also that we may worthily receive this holy sacrament and partake of his most blessed body and blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ and one as your church, that Christ may dwell in us and we in him. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ and gather us together with all your saints in the joy of your heavenly kingdom, where we shall see our Lord face to face. We ask this through your Son, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit in your holy church be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. And now, with the confidence of children of God, let us join together in our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. This bread is the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, given for you. May it preserve your body and soul to everlasting life. This cup is the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Drink this in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for you. Let us pray. We do not presume to come to this your table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your abundant and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs from under your table, but you are the same Lord whose character is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen. You're invited to come to the altar, to come by the center aisle and to either kneel or to stand at the altar, whichever is easier for you. You'll be given a piece of bread. Please take and eat it. You'll be given a cup of juice. Please take and drink it. And after you have received the bread and the cup, we invite you to remain for a moment of prayer at the altar. Maybe you want to pray for our friends in Ecuador. Maybe you want to pray for our church. Maybe you want to pray for our world. Spend a moment in prayer and then return back to your seats using the side aisle. If you would like to receive the sacrament but are unable to come to the altar rail, wave at us or get our attention and we would be glad to bring the sacrament to you. Tim will be helping me to serve this morning, and we'll serve from the front to the back as the ushers direct you. So the Lord's table is open. Would you come to receive the love and the mercy and the goodness of God? as we come to a time of response in our service. The altar is open if you would like to come and pray. Maybe you would like to pray for our friends in Ecuador, that God would work in and through them, even as they pray for us. Maybe you would also like to know more about what it means to be born again and to accept Christ as your Lord and Savior. If so, Tim or myself would be glad to talk with you about that. Or if you'd like to know more about becoming a member of our church here at Grace, as we seek to make a difference in our own community and around the world, we would be glad to talk with you about those things as well. Our closing hymn is Jesus Calls Us, number 520. Would you please stand as we sing together? We are so grateful for Tim and his work. And Tim, we have a gift for you, so if you'll come and receive it. Part of our gift is from our faith promise that we give over and above our tithes and offerings to support Tim and our other missionaries, our other mission partners and their work. So if you would like to make a gift for Faith Promise, then you can do so and mark it Faith Promise, and that way we will know that you want it to go toward our mission and ministry work. So Tim, we're grateful for you. We're grateful for the message that you have brought us. We're grateful for the need that we have to be born again, and we pray that Christ would work in and through your work in Ecuador, even as we pray that Christ would work in and through us. I do want to remind you that some of the leadership board will be available to you in the fellowship hall if you'd like to talk with them. Beginning next week, we will be talking about what it means to be a global Methodist and looking at the mission of the Global Methodist Church. And so I hope you'll join us for that as we explore what it means to be a global Methodist. And so let us close in prayer. Oh Lord, we're grateful for the day that you've given us. We're grateful for your work around the world, for your work in and through Tim and Dana where they are in Ecuador. Lord, we pray your continued blessings on their work, that you would expand it, that you would grow it, and Lord, that people would come to know Jesus through their work. Lord, even as they work in that place, Lord, we know that you call us to work where we are. And so, Lord, we pray that you would fill us with your Spirit, that you would help us to be born again, so that others would be able to see Jesus in us through the things that we do and say. For, Lord, we know that your mission is not just here. It is not just around the world. It is wherever we go and wherever you are. So, Lord, we ask your continued blessing on Tim and his work, even as we pray you would bless us. And now, Lord, as we go from this place, we pray that you would go with us and that others would see Jesus in us through the things that we say and do. And it's all these things we ask in the name of Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.